Topics on the Hill, NCU. Topics on the Hill, all you need to know about NCU. Come learn about your school and be in the know about the current affairs. If there is ever a time that you're in doubt, Topics on the Hill is here.
Ananda Dean, Jasmine Dean, and Kenise Jackson. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and thank you for tuning in to this, the season finale of Topics on the Hill, a program for the students by the students. I'm Ramon Gordon, and this afternoon our program assumes a more somber tone.
That's right, Ramon. To start our program off this evening, we will be engaging in a conversation about the sad reality affecting our women here in Jamaica and what we can do to help. I am Amoy Harriet.
And later in our show, we will host an academic year in review with outgoing USM President Ruel Hay, followed by an interview with incoming President Sir Neil Brivett. Ladies and gentlemen, we have quite an eventful show planned for you. You simply cannot afford to miss it. You're watching Topics on the Hill. We'll be right back.
There is ever a time that you're in doubt. Topics on the Hill is here. Topics on the Hill is here. Topics on the Hill is here.
The next person in line, your friend at school or your coworker, may have COVID-19 and not know because they have no symptoms. You, on the other hand, could be hospitalized for 2 months or more if you become infected. Is it worth it? Stay socially connected, but keep the physical distance. Stay 6 feet away and avoid a hospital stay. COVID-19 is not over. Protect yourself while protecting others. A message from the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
Hello? 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 Yeah, you. Hold on, and a pandemic, we know. You're not wearing a mask, you're not washing a hand, and you're not keep the required 6 feet distancing from other people. How could I really cause you? You need to stop it. That no mask, no wash, and no distance, something there, nah keep. You know what I keep? COVID-19, yeah. It no gone nowhere. COVID-19, they are same way. So here why you are going to do for all of we. Wear your mask, wash or sanitize your hands pan a regular, and yeah, keep your distance, please, and thanks.
Democracy needs journalism, and journalism needs objective reporting, especially in the realm of student government.
A platform must be created to voice the concerns and issues of the students. They must be heard.
And Topics on the Hill is that platform. Join us every other Tuesday from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. on NCU TV Jamaica on YouTube.
Share your feedback on our social media page where we post our questions. Go ahead, comment. Let's know what you think. You can also email us at hilltoptrumpet.ncu.edu.jm. And let us hear the challenges that you are facing. You can also direct message us. Tell us what's going on.
Let us speak out for you on Topics on the Hill.
Welcome back to Topics on the Hill. To start our program off this afternoon, Rahman, just before the break, you would have mentioned a few names: Ananda Dean, Jasmine Dean, and Kanice Jackson. Viewers, these are just few of thousands of women who suffer the criminality here in Jamaica, the place that we supposedly call home.
The scourge of crime has been unforgiving, mm-hmm. and our island's most vulnerable have not been spared. Joining us in studio via Zoom is motivational speaker, author, and politician Miss Crystal Tomlinson, and pastor and counseling psychologist Pastor Joel Shillingford.
But just before they join us, we have Nicolay Gunn with the topical view.
Thank you so much, Amoy. Welcome to Topical View, where we listen to your thoughts and concerns. Now, we have some very strong comments here from Instagram and also from various places that we have posted. We have our listeners and viewers saying, some counseling. Behind every behavior lies a reason. We have another commenter saying, they need to be punished. A part of prison is rehabilitation. They'll have a lot of time on their hands. Another one says, once forensic evidence confirm the offender guilty, then castration or death penalty is possible sentence. In order for us not to punish the wrong person, our forensic system would need improvement. But castration and death penalty would be some good penalty once person is found guilty. We have another one saying, the government should implement the death penalty, execution for rapists. Prison not doing no justice for those sickening men. We have another saying, we will never advocate for such extremes. You create more monsters. In law, it's a dangerous setting. What's the equivalent for the female? Clearly, the system in place isn't working. Another person says, unlike popular beliefs, I wouldn't side with death as a penalty for rape. While rape is a cruel act, I believe that the person carrying out the act have a story. There is a reason for their behavior. The hardening of the heart will cause that one should be punished severely for the crime or violence committed. But I believe imprisonment can suffice while we seek to understand the actions and behaviors of these individuals. Thank you so much for your comments. Do find yourself under or post on Instagram, or you can always email us. So let's hear what you have to say on this topic.
This is how I want Jamaica to remember Canis. It's 4 years I know Canis, you know. If I tell you this, the things that we go through, it will be unbelievable. You literally cry. You could listen to me for hours. I have so much things I can tell you about Canis. So much good memories, you'd be unbelievable. She was a living angel, Jamaica, I can tell you that. There's no hiding or going around that. Canis was our living angel. That is God's blessing to me, her mom, her family, everybody who she touched. That was a blessing from God. And sometimes God takes back his angels. And it's just so unfortunate she had to go like this. Please, I don't want Jamaica to paint in Canis in any image. We, the family, and many people around her know who she was. She was a sweet, innocent, honest, nice, caring, passionate. Even if you don't like her, she can find a way to still help you. That's what she is, and she's not doing it in an aggressive way. She's doing it in a way that she knows she eventually just can, you know?
Anybody who wants to say that she was this type of person, or that them don't know her, they don't know her. She's just like her mother. Most of the time, you have to wonder if she live here.
Yeah.
You understand? If you don't come to get something from her, you see her walking down the aisle out here, and you stop and talk. Because she don't run for all about from yard to yard.
No,
she don't do that.
No,
and she, just like we, our mother, she, she's even more reserved than our mother, and our mother is very reserved.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? You can only say good things about her. Good things about her, nothing bad.
Connie is interested enough in the past. And Connie used to talk about what would happen if one of us died. And I told her. And I told her, I'm diabetic and I have type 1. So I said, I may pass before you. And she said, you can't leave me with the kids. You can't leave me with the kids. And how can I manage without with the kids? And she said, I gotta make sure you eat and stay healthy so I can stay fit. So I can be around. And she said, what if she would pass? And I said, I can't go on without you. And she said, no, you have to stay strong for the kids and you have to move on, because I wanted to move on. And I never understand what she meant until now. I never understand. And I know, because she want me to be strong, because she know how strong I am. She know, she always tell me that's why. She respects me so much because I'm so strong. I can't tell you a million and one stories about her and me. I can't tell you. Because everywhere we go, people always admire us, different age group, old, young. They say, I want what you guys have. Even the school we went to see the group, oh God, and the principal. And the principal tell us, no, these guys are really special.
Again, a special welcome to our guests, Miss Crystal Tomlinson and Pastor Shillingford. Thank you so much for joining us. Are you here? Miss Tomlinson? Pastor Shillingford?
Good afternoon. I did not hear your previous statement.
Miss Tomlinson?
Hearing you clearly?
Yes, Pastor, we're hearing you clearly. Thank you again for being here. Amoy?
Is Ms. Tomlinson here with us this afternoon?
All right, in the meantime, Pastor Shillingford. All right, she's here. Thank you so much. Ms. Tomlinson, to start our conversation this evening, I want to get a reaction from you to what has been an upsurge in violent crimes against women and children here on our island. You know, I don't even think that's a fair assessment, because even though instances of these crimes are being reported more frequently now, they've always been an area of concern. So, Ms. Tomlinson, just to start and to establish a bit of context, how are you feeling?
There's nothing less than anger that could really describe how I feel right now. The challenge for me has always been, how do we redesign our society? Because we've created this Jamaica. We, by virtue of the laws, policies, practices, cultural beliefs about what a healthy relationship looks like, what love feels like, what value is placed on a woman's body and her voice, but also we being human beings, we birthed our political system and our independent Jamaica from an experience with vicious slavery. So a lot of us are used to, psychologically, the legacy of abuse being a part of our experience, or economic experience, or interpersonal experience. It's violence that got us here, it's violence that got us out, and for too many of us, that national healing of the Black nation, not just Jamaica, but the healing that needs to take place of the Black body and the Black mind simply has not happened. We don't have conversations about the psychological impact of the economic system that we're coming out of. And I think that just kind of snowballs into the current reality. Because unfortunately, when you look at societies that are predominantly Caucasian and Asian, you don't find these high levels of violence. It's specifically related to the structures that brought us into the Western Hemisphere and that have allowed, we have allowed, because of our relationship with hegemonic powers, to stay. So I think it's a very complicated issue, but at this point, anger is the base of the emotion I'm feeling right now.
And on that note, Pastor, I want to hear your perspective as well, based on what you see happening in the world today. And let's make it even small and more direct. In Jamaica, do you think there's a problem with how women are being treated right now?
Good afternoon. And I truly want to sympathize with the family of the deceased. But yes, there is truly a problem with how men treat women in Jamaica for the past decade and a half, a couple of decades back. However, also there is a problem as to how we treat each other. So now it's not only a matter of how women are treated, but how we treat each other in intimate partner relationships. And but definitely in Jamaica, as we speak, our women are suffering some terrible things at the hands of men.
Thank you, Pastor. Ms. Tomlinson, back to you. How do we begin to hold our culture accountable? Because we have a lot of conversations after the fact about criminals and whatsoever mm-hmm. else, but we never talk about the way of life, or we rarely talk about the way of life that influences their actions. So how do we begin to dismantle and critically assess a society that has at its foundation misogyny, bigotry, and worst of them all, violence?
I think the first thing that has to happen is truth. There's no way to reconcile it without facing it, and there's no way to understand the solution to the problem without truth. We don't speak honestly about our experiences with violence. We don't speak honestly about the feelings that precede violent activity. Our children are not taught to describe emotions in that way. So if you ask a young man or a young woman after they physically assaulted somebody, why did you do that? Then diss me. It means that they have challenged your perception of self. What about the way you have defined yourself makes you so fragile to the opinion of somebody else? Because they didn't hit you first, so you're not telling me it's self-defense, but them diss you. What is disrespect? And how do you change the way you view disrespect? Why do our men think disrespect, the ultimate disrespect, is born? Why do our men believe that the ultimate disrespect is that a woman has moved on to another man? Why do we interpret disrespect to mean someone doing something with their own body that gives us permission to assault again their person? So we have to first of all begin to get really honest about what is going on. We are raising children to believe that they have authority over other people's bodies, other people's thoughts, and other people's actions, and that is not true. Or parents, as they exercise discipline over their children, are exercising discipline in that way too. I am your mother. I put food on the table. I pay the bills. I take care of you. So if you don't do what I say you should do, I have authority to knock you down flat on the ground. Mm. Not that I am angry and I don't have any other way to correct your behavior except to slap you. So it's really my fault for not knowing how to discipline you beyond beat you. But you tell them that the beating is earned and I have a right to beat you because I feed you. And a lot of young men leave their households with that thought. There are young women who leave home and say, well, me don't want nobody beat me, so me, I'm going to pay my own bills and I'm going to live under my own roof. Mm-hmm. Because if you live with a partner, they now earn authority to beat you if they're paying the light bill. And you'll hear a lot of that, even in the conversations with the accused, because he's not yet convicted around the Kanice Jackson murder. A big part of it was that he was doing her favors. Yes, he thought that if he was giving her a free drive, there was some kind of courtesy now owed to him, courtesy related to her body. So if I take care of a woman, she is now mine. If I mine you, you are mine. So we have to start there. It's a very complex issue. I only use that as an example. But culturally, we have to redefine what it means to live lovingly with others, what it means to discipline and how you can disagree in a healthy way. Conflict resolution in schools, retooling our school environment with more guidance counselors. You can't have one guidance counselor assigned to 500 children coming from 500 households with 500 different psychosocial issues to deal with. It's never going to get dealt with.
No.
And every child must pass through primary school in Jamaica. So that's an opportunity at primary and high school to identify psychological issues that they may have, behavioral problems, assign them to psychological coaches, provide parenting mentorship to their parents, track the behavior, put the parents back in school. There's a whole thing that needs to happen to re-socialize our families. And then from there, we'll begin to see changes in the society. But we have to start with truth.
Ms. Tomlinson, there's a video going around on social media. Mm-hmm. And in the video, we see a member of parliament, an elected official, ravaging a woman. He is beating her and throwing her about like a rag doll. Now, the clip, you know, has caused a lot of outrage, and rightfully so. But what I want to ask you is this. Do you think we ought to make an example of him? And if so, what punishment do you think is most appropriate?
I think he should be punished within the parameters of the law. So the most extreme legal consequence that can be brought to bear is, of course, by recommendation. So we must allow the police to do their jobs. His political friends in government must not try to intimidate and influence the process in any way. And the judge must understand his or her role when it comes to sentencing, what social signal he or she will send with the sentence. So it can't be a reduced sentence. Right. It can't be a discounted sentence, because this is a moment now to shift our perception that power buys you authority above the law, because that's what we think about power now. So this is an opportunity to, as you rightfully said, make a sound example of this specific case, but nothing beyond what the law already allows. But I think the Prime Minister now has a lot more latitude in how he approaches this. There's a sitting of parliament happening now. Up to the time that we started this conversation, I've not heard the Prime Minister's comment on the matter, whether he has requested the resignation, whether he has rethought the government's position on blocking a motion to have him suspended from the House, whether the JLP has expelled or suspended his membership from the party. He is in charge of the country. He has the biggest microphone, the widest pulpit, and the voice that will reverberate across the world. So he has an opportunity here to send a strong and clear signal that at the highest point in governance and power in this country, we have a no-tolerance approach. I'm not a judge. I don't need to hear evidence from both sides. The police have confirmed that you are the man in the video, and that is enough for me. And I don't know if he will do it before Parliament's sitting ends, but I think that is where he has an opportunity to send a clear signal to women and girls and boys who are viciously weighed down by abuse, especially by powerful people, to know that the Prime Minister will be on my side and the law will be on my side, so I can at least speak up now and tell the truth about what has been happening to me.
All right, Ms. Tomlinson, I have one more question for you. Do you think the government has been doing enough to protect our women and children? Because from the tit-for-tat about abortion and even sometimes the more sinister conversations we have about sexual assault and things of that nature, many persons believe that the government has not been an effective advocate for our nation's most vulnerable. What say you? Have our legislators and our elected officials been doing enough to protect us?
My answer to that is no. Crime is an issue that affects every single Jamaican, and not one of us can say we feel safe in this society. We feel secure when we close our doors and our windows. We still feel at risk. We're not sure if when we go to the police station, they will take our report and act as best they can. Too many women are coming back after trying to make a report about abuse in their household. The police officer telling them to go back home, whether they are inappropriately dressed or it is curfew, so you must go back home. So there are too many instances that tell women that you're not safe even if you go to the police. You're not safe even if you go to the media. You're not safe if you bring it to the church. You're not safe if you tell a journalist, perhaps. You're just at risk. So it's better you take the risk of another beating at home than to become a public spectacle and still be getting beating or abuse at home. So I think the government has several things they need to do. One is to commit to social and behavioral change, and that takes money. You have to be investing in more social workers in our schools, partnering with the churches beyond asking them to pray for you once a year at a prayer breakfast, partnering with our churches that have massive influence in our communities, massive influence over the women who are heads of households, the men who are heads of households. Give the church a clear role in participating in the reduction of violence. How do you incentivize and retrain a group of clergymen and women with how they talk about violence and the role of women and discipline in the household? What do you now ask of them when they have the Sunday school? What should they be looking out for in the behaviors of children? How do you prepare them to identify challenges in families and then feel safe to report some of that so that the state can take care of it? Additionally, how do you give the state more resources so that when you have to move children from abusive households, move women from abusive households?
Yes, remember we said 30.
So I don't think it's a one thing that they... I'm sorry, was that an error on my part, Joel? Or... Can you hear me?
All right, Ms. Tomlinson, we're having some technical...
I'm hearing you clearly now.
Okay.
All right, great.
I'm not sure where the audio got disconnected. but I'll just wrap it up. What I'm suggesting is identifying the key stakeholders, giving them a clear role to play beyond stand up for your community. Tell them exactly what you want them to do. Equip them with the resources to participate in the process, retrain, retool, and fund the shelters, the state care facilities, so that people are actually safer when you take them out of abusive households.
All right, Pastor. Now I want to hear your perspective on the questions that Ramon had just asked. Do you believe the government is doing enough? If not, what more do you suggest they do?
Well, firstly, we need to look at first world nations and how they have dealt with the issue of domestic violence, intimate partner violence. For example, in Ireland, they tackled this program or this problem with research. It was a research-based solution. And what they uncovered is that men who were abused as children, suffered childhood trauma, they were more prone to engage in domestic violence against women. So Ms. Tomlinson is on the ball. I'm in agreement with her. Also, our civic groups, our churches, they must play their role as well in teaching, educating, nurturing, especially as it relates to young men. If a young man has not seen what it means to be a man in a home, he's going to have a difficult problem adjusting himself in a relationship. If a young man has not experienced how to be properly fathered, he's going to have a problem. In Ireland also, this government, they chose to go the route of education and implementation and more so policy. So within the Jamaican context, we need to begin with why is it that we have this problem in Jamaica? Let us fund it, let us fund some research. I think we have the bright minds in Jamaica. And then adjust or tailor make our response to this issue of domestic violence. It has worked in other countries. It has worked in several countries, I must say, and I believe it can work in Jamaica.
All right, thank you, Pastor. Now, you are also a psychologist. I was viewing the statistics earlier today of the number of women who are raped, sexually assaulted, and who even goes missing each year, and the number is alarming. But quite frankly, I want to go out on a limb right here and say that this does not reflect every single case, because there are cases that goes unreported. Now, what would you say as a psychologist to a young girl or a young woman who is afraid of speaking out when she was sexually abused or violated?
Thank you for that question. The point of speaking out as a human being is a basic right that we have. If you feel that right is withheld from you, then something is wrong. And any society that causes a woman to feel that she's wrong to speak out is a sick society. Now, we must take control of this thing from the root. So for example, if a woman sees that she has been abused, then it must be reported. If I know as a pastor that this young girl in my church or this young boy in my church was abused or is being abused, then I must report. However, as it relates to young ladies and speaking out, we need to muster the courage, and as a society, and I hear Ms. Tomlinson spoke about the government, if we know those in authority are with us and will assist us in fighting this battle, then I believe women will be more prone to speak out, boys will be more prone to speak out. So I think this systemic problem has to be dealt in a systemic way.
All right, thank you, Pastor.
Thank you both for being here, Miss Crystal Tomlinson and Pastor Shillingford. On the other side of this break, we're going to have our academic year in review. What did we accomplish? What could we have done a little better? You're watching Topics on the Hill. We'll be right back.
March 10th, 2020 was the day COVID-19 turned our lives upside down. But thankfully, March 10th, 2021 was the day we got hope that the pandemic will end. With the COVID-19 vaccine now being available to Jamaicans across the island, it means that very soon we can get back to normal. These vaccines are both safe and effective and will ensure that you and your loved ones are protected and can get back to the things you love most, like partying, going to church, like family dinners, like simply giving your mom or dad a hug. I have been vaccinated, and I am encouraging each and every Jamaican to take the vaccine when it is available to your group. Let us put a stop to the COVID-19 pandemic. Let us get vaccinated so we can get back to life.
On your marks, get set. Are you ready for Week of Excellence 2021? Well, pack your bags and let's go. The Department of Communication Studies Week of Excellence, under the theme Developing Skills Built on Character, we kick things off on April 10 with our church service, leading up to April 15 with a grand social. And at 5 p.m. on April 18, we bring the curtains down with our annual Lignum Vitae Film Festival. That's the Department of Communication Studies Week of Excellence, April 10 to 15 and 18, 2021. Be there.
Journalism, TV, PR, radio. Still one family, get you know it. Go tell you enough, me not fi share no more info. Everywhere we go, we rep DCS for sure. Week of Excellence, them can't pass without consent. Come out and be proud, cause we magnificent. All of DCS full of talents. Week of Excellence, come from the hills, the valley mountains. Show everybody, bring all of your friends. Make this song be a new anthem. Week of Excellence.
excellence. Week of excellence.
Be there.
Hello? Hello?
Hello? Yeah, you.
Hold on, and a pandemic, weena. You're not wearing a mask, you're not washing your hand, and you're not keep the required 6 feet distancing from other people. How could I really cause you? You need to stop it. That no mask, no wash, and no distance something there, nah keep. You know what keep? COVID-19. Yeah, it no gone nowhere. COVID-19, they are same way. So here why you are going to do for all of we. Wear your mask, wash or sanitize your hands pan a regular, and yeah, keep your distance, please, and thanks.
Every time that you're in doubt, topics on the hill is here.
Academic year in review. Viewers, welcome back to Topics on the Hill. You know, I feel like I have a lot to say in regards to this academic year, Ramon. But just before we dive into that discussion, please take a look at this video clip.
Protocols being established. Good afternoon, everyone. I am particularly humbled to stand here before you as your president to lead at such a time as this.
We're happy that you have decided to be a part of this program geared at producing an initiative to raise funds for you, our students. Through the launch of the United Student Movement Recipients Fund, an initiative aimed at making students' lives better in context of monetary allocation and mentorship.
Interview with CBS, and I'll stick by this, that there are so many things that are still ambiguous to me and that I'm learning on a daily basis. It doesn't matter how successful you are, all the training and experience that you've got in life, there are going to be things that you just do not know.
For tertiary institutions, now we're talking about teenagers and young adults, if you're a sickler, if you're asthmatic, if you have a heart condition, you know, your kidney problem, and so on, then you are at higher risk. And this has been so with not just with COVID-19, but with many of the infectious diseases.
Skies out there.
in Jamaica, and I said, smile, girl, smile. Oh, light, smile for me in Jamaica. Never you cry, here am I, girl.
Welcome to the only place to be as we watch and discuss the USM elections. This show will indicate or discuss the president and vice presidents for the 2021-2022 regime. I'm Rajay Danvers.
And I'm Chanel Mills. Today we'll be giving you live updates on the election. We'll also be tapping into our social media so that you can speak to the candidates vying for offices. We'll also be doing the big thing, Rajay, which is introducing who will be our next USM president. All this and more on USM Decision 2021.
At this time, categorically, that you were unaware of an objective of a goal to remove you from office because it is seen that you're being an ineffective president. Is that what you're saying?
Or you're not being as effective
no,
as you
No, that is not what
be.
I'm saying. Because
what are you
that's
saying?
Not what I answered to. That wasn't the question that you asked.
I don't
So
well,
don't try to twist it as a journalist. Stick to the
answer,
context.
Answer the question,
that
Mr.
you
president.
Created.
What a year it has been, Raman.
Oh, God.
It has been one for the books, as you would say.
It has been quite
No, Raman,
yes.
This is your final academic year. For those watching right
oh,
now
gosh.
Who did not know,
oh, God.
This is probably the last time
oh,
you
gosh.
Will be seeing Raman on Topics on the Hill.
You're going to make me emotional. Why do that?
No, I have to ask you. What was your highlight of this academic year?
Oh, this academic year in particular?
This specific one.
I think my favorite part of the semester was being here. And I don't want to come off as being biased, but being on set every 2 weeks, planning, writing, having conversation with Shanessa and Suzelle and everyone else and posing for the photos.
Yes.
You know, I really look forward to all that excitement
yes.
and all that it, you know, has prepared me for.
Mm-hmm.
Because like I said, I graduate in a few months, in 3 months. And I'm leaving with Shanessa and Adrian in there and Jadon and Suzelle and everybody else who graduated.
Right.
So I feel like I am about to step into a new chapter of my life with a small family,
mm-hmm.
with a group of people who have prepared me. We prepared each other really for what comes hereafter. So Topics on the Hill.
Right.
Was the highlight for me, but for you, let's hear it.
I would have to say the same, Raman. This was an amazing experience. I enjoyed every second of it, you know, stepping outside your shell, doing something new. It makes you feel good. It makes you feel like you can, you know, put yourself out there and get the job done.
Yeah.
And I must say that this was absolutely my favorite part of this academic year. And I know we're doing academic year in review, but since this is your final year, Raman.
Oh, you're putting me on the spot. I hate
this might be a hard one, but... Which year was your favorite year?
What year was my favorite? Oh, am I going to... Okay, let me tell you.
Mm-hmm. I have to know why, you know. You have to tell me why.
My favorite year was 2017.
What year were you in? That was your second...
I was in
my second
year.
Mm-hmm.
So I started NCU in 2016, but when I registered as a student, I was studying law. I was studying criminal justice.
Mm-hmm.
So I had every intention of graduating and going on to wherever else to get my law degree and become
right.
an attorney. But I was so bored... It was so boring
right.
reading law books and doing this and that. I couldn't be bothered really.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted something that excited me. I wanted something that was fun. So I, at the behest of a lot of my friends, decided to switch to journalism.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I found myself. That's where I found my chosen family.
Right.
That's where I became Ramon Gordon.
Right.
And without DCS, without Noreen Daly, without Laurie Henry,
absolutely,
without Roma Tomlinson White,
mm-hmm,
without all of those teachers contributing to my development and the development of my friends,
mm-hmm,
none of this would be possible. Because
absolutely,
I don't think people understand and appreciate the fact that this is a student-led production.
Right.
The lighting, the cameras, the teleprompter, the scripts we're writing, everything is done by students. So
mm-hmm,
when we say it's a program by the students, for the students, it's not no hanky-panky, we're not making that up. You understand?
Yes.
So that I'm rambling. You let me ramble.
We love it. We love it.
2017
was
my favorite
year. It's your last episode,
yeah,
so you have to,
yeah,
let them know everything.
Right. 2017 was my favorite year. That's that.
Yes.
Next question. Mm-hmm.
And I must say, Ramon, this year was the first full academic year. We were entirely online,
mm-hmm,
doing everything within the confines of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
And I must say that I'm in awe,
yeah,
with how our students worked their way around it.
Yeah.
They made everything work smoothly,
yeah,
despite, you know, the virus, and,
yeah,
and everyone was keeping safe, right?
Right.
So I'm absolutely happy, I'm absolutely pleased, and I must say that I'm proud of every student, especially the ones working on this production. We're gonna big them up later, because, you know, we,
yeah,
have to big them up.
Right.
It's a final episode for this,
right,
season,
right,
so we have to big them up. But just before we end this segment, Ramon, I must ask you, going, leaving NCU,
uh-huh,
right now, may I have to ask a question, man? We are leaving right now, very briefly,
uh-huh,
leaving NCU,
uh-huh,
what's one thing that you'll never forget?
Oh, I will never forget becoming me. I will never forget all the nights I cried in the library. I will never forget the panic attacks. I will never forget being unable to write a new story for the first time. I will never forget all the experiences that, you know, have led me to where I am right now. And I'll forever be grateful for all of that. I'm not going to cry, Shanessa. I hear you telling me to cry. I'm not going to cry. What we are going to do, ladies and gentlemen, is go for a break. On the other side of this break, we're going to have President-elect of the United Students Movement, Sir Neil Rivette. Don't go too far. You're watching Topics on the Hill. We'll be right back.
Topics on the Hill is here.
March 10th, 2020 was the day COVID-19 turned our lives upside down. But thankfully, March 10th, 2021 was the day we got hope that the pandemic will end. With the COVID-19 vaccine now being available to Jamaicans across the island, it means that very soon we can get back to normal. These vaccines are both safe and effective and will ensure that you and your loved ones are protected and can get back to the things you love most, like partying, going to church, like family dinners, like simply giving your mom or dad a hug. I have been vaccinated and I'm encouraging each and every Jamaican to take the vaccine when it is available to your group. Let us put a stop to the COVID-19 pandemic. Let us get vaccinated so we can get back to life.
On your marks, get set. Are you ready for Week of Excellence 2021? Well, pack your bags and let's go. The Department of Communication Studies Week of Excellence, under the theme Developing Skills Built on Character, we kick things off on April 10 with our church service, leading up to April 15 with a grand social. And at 5 p.m. on April 18, we bring the curtains down with our annual Lignum Vitae Film Festival. That's the Department of Communication Studies Week of Excellence, April 10 to 15 and 18, 2021. Be there.
Specialty, all the love and energy. Them can't talk as we all grimy. Journalism, TV, PR, radio. Sin one family, get you know it. Go tell you enough, me not fish share no more info. Everywhere we go, we rep DCS for sure.
Lake of excellence, them can't pass without consent. Come out and be proud as we magnificent. All of DCS full up our talents. Week of excellence, come from the hills, the valley mountains. Sure, everybody bring all of your friends. Make this song be a new anthem. Week of excellence, week of excellence, week of excellence, week of excellence.
Be there. Hello? 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 Yeah, you.
Hold on, and a pandemic, we
you're not wearing a mask, you're not washing a hand, and you're not keep the required 6 feet distancing from other people. How could I really cause you? You need to stop it. That no mask, no wash, and no distance, something there, nah keep. You know what I keep? COVID-19, yeah. It no gone nowhere. COVID-19, they are same way. So here why you are going to do for all away. Wear your mask, wash or sanitize your hands pan a regular, and yeah, keep your distance, please. And thanks.
Every time that you're in doubt, topics on the hill is here.
Welcome back to Topics on the Hill. We're almost at the end of the show, but not before you hear from our president-elect, Neil Brivett, that we have in studio with us. Good evening, Mr. Neil Brivett. First of all, how are you feeling? I feel lighting up the mood, you know?
Yeah, I'm feeling great. I'm feeling great, to be honest. I'm this person, though.
Yes.
I'm this person. But I feel great, and I feel honored to be a part of the Topics on the Hill.
Right.
I feel really honored.
You ran a very grassroots campaign. Yeah, WhatsApp was ablaze, Facebook was ablaze,
right.
Instagram
YouTube
was ablaze.
Was ablaze.
Neil Brivett. Mm-hmm. How did you accomplish that, especially in the middle of a pandemic?
Well, the team, to be honest. I had persons who were just excited and faithful, you know, and everyone just made contact and, you know, shared with everyone else, you know, and it all came together well. Personally, it was... me relating to them, my ideas, mm-hmm. and they taking it to the student population.
What is it about your ideas that you think resonated with the students?
Well, it all surrounds the students. You know, they see, I think, in my plans and ideas that I am here to focus on them because mm-hmm. many times we neglect, we come with ideas, but we don't consider what they want.
Right.
You know, we come and force idea thinking, this is what they need, this is what they need. Mm-hmm. But what about what they say they need?
Right.
So I think that was one of my focal points.
And with that being said, I have to ask you, what's one of the things that you're most excited about implementing in your regime?
Well, to date, there are two projects that I have basically organized, mm-hmm. yet to share it with my team, so I can share limited information about it. But the first is the MOL program, Maintaining Our Legacy, that will see us... basically uniting with the USM alumni mm-hmm. for them to do a series of training, you know, because I think the students will put more trust in the United Student Movement body mm-hmm. if they see that they are capable and they are confident in what they're doing. And so we want the expertise from the alumni, and so we'll execute that program. The second one is Project R29, so it's representation, 2 phases, 9 months. That you will hear more about.
Sounds intriguing, yeah. Armand.
I want to hear a little bit more of the backstory. I want to get a bit of context because running for president of the United Students Movement mm-hmm. is not an easy feat. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've been elected, so you have some pretty large shoes to fill.
Right.
So that could not have been a decision that you took lightly. Talk to us a little about the process behind making the man.
The process. Well, when I came to NCU, I I think it was in my second year that I said that I would be United Student Movement president. as time goes by, I didn't see myself as that, and my focus shifted. But then it was my calling to work for the students, work with the students, and to be a servant leader. I'm a religion student, and so that is my calling. And so what better way to do it than to serve the students and lead them in the direction that I think is best and most beneficial to them? You know, so it is my servant leader attitude and my call from God firstly that motivates me to actually make this decision. And of course, there are other persons, you know, past presidents, current students who will say, you know, Neil, you're the man for the job. You're the man for the job. You know, and that I just took up the mantle.
Now, Neil, I have to ask you, you know, do you have any fears going into the new regime?
Fears.
Fears or concerns?
Well, to be honest, no. Because one thing I've realized is that failure is a must, and persons will fail, right? But the thing is, what do you do after that? Are you innovative enough to be looking ahead, right? And so I anticipate the rejection that I'll get from the administration, from persons. I anticipate the negativity, but I'm planning ahead. You know, I'm implementing strategies that will not limit us as a movement. And so really and truly, I'm just excited about serving. My team and I, we're excited, and we're looking forward to the experience.
You mentioned earlier something about servant leadership. I wanted to very briefly explain that concept to those who might not be so familiar. And I want you to also tell us, you know, to what extent, really, that is the driving force behind you.
Jesus is the prime example for everything. And Jesus was the greatest leader I've ever seen. But how did he lead? He led by serving those around him. Ellen White says that it is only Christ method alone that will reap true success, you know. The Savior mingled with them. He, you know, understand their needs, won their confidence, and then bade them follow me. That is what captures a servant leader. Knows the needs of the students, mingle with the students, and then win their confidence, and then say, come. Let us move forward.
Incredible.
Absolutely wonderful. Now, this academic year is about to close. Ruel's year was the first full academic year, as we stated earlier, to be completely online, working in the confines of the pandemic. Now, I have to ask you, based on what you've seen over this year, is there anything that was implemented or done that you plan to, you know, bring over into your year?
Most definitely. The topics on the hill.
No.
Right.
it's a tremendous program. And if I can bring it over and even expand on it, that would be exciting. That would really be exciting.
All right. Thank you so much, Neil. Now, I am very excited to see what you, and especially that R29.
Project R29.
R29. I want to see what that's all about. Students, stay tuned with Neil, the upcoming semester, the upcoming academic year, to find out all that he has in store for us. And as usual, here at NCU, God is in the center of every single thing that we do. And as such, at this time, I now invite Nathaniel Hamilton, forgive me, Mr. Hamilton. He will take us out with the closing prayer.
Let us pray. Oh, Father, friend, we are very grateful for life and for strength. We thank you that you've been a good God to us. We pray that even now, God, that as we are petitioning the throne of grace, that you will wash us thoroughly from within and without. I pray, God, that you will forgive us for all our sins we've committed in the past, in the day that our prayer will not go in vain. Then, God, I lift up before you for the many women that are crying out in Jamaica, the many families that are mourning for a loss of a loved one or whatever. I pray that you will be a daddy, be a mother, be a comforter, be a provider. I pray that you will be a close friend to somebody. I pray, God, that you will anoint them with your power. I pray that you will give them strength and the anointing that they need to stand. I pray, God, for the many young men and women that the devil have captive even now. I pray that you will rescue them. Rescue them from sin, death, and the grave. I pray, God, that even now you will walk into somebody's life and cramperalize the plans of the enemy and loose somebody, I pray. Pray, God, that when time on earth ceases, that you will save to the uttermost. That when you come, when you burst that eastern sky, that we will hear from your lips, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things, and I'll make you ruler over many. Until that day, we're anticipating the great getting up morning. Until that day, we're anticipating when these things shall be no more. We wait your coming in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Hamilton, for that prayer. We truly do feel blessed. Ladies and gentlemen, viewers at home, we are at the end of the season finale, Ramon. We can't believe it.
I can't believe it.
I swear.
I remember getting the call 2 years ago from Suzel to join the team. I was apprehensive at first because I didn't want to come on camera and get ready every 2 weeks to be on camera. But, you know, I took the leap of faith and I found a home here. And it's just sad that I'm going to be leaving along with, you know, people I really and truly care about. I have to say a special thank you to our producer, Miss Shanessa Hall.
Big up, Suzel. Big up, Shanessa.
Yeah, executive producer, Miss Suzel Ray, my very good friend, let me say that. And just to everybody who made this production possible. Ladies and gentlemen, this was Topics on the Hill. I'm Ramon Gordon.
And I'm Amoy Harriot. See you next season.
Topics on the